إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My name is Abdul Bari Yahya, and I will be your host for today. We will be speaking about lessons that we can derive from the Medinan period. Lessons in da'wah. Because, as you know, this is a series on the art of da'wah. And so we're going to derive lessons from some of the incidents that happened during the Medinan period. When we say the Medinan period, it means after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We will start with the ending of the hijrah. The hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Mecca to Medina was a very important trip. It was a turning point in Islamic history. Towards the end of the trip, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam met two known famous thieves. These two thieves, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met them and called them to Islam. And then they accepted Islam, and the Prophet ﷺ asked them, "What are your names?" And they said, "We are called Al-Muhanan." Al-Muhanan means the despised ones, the two despised ones. In other words, these people were thieves, and so they called themselves despised ones. You know how, like, some people, you know, they, instead of using good names to call themselves, sometimes they use names that put them down and so forth. You see, sometimes some of the rappers, they do this, and instead of calling themselves $1 million, they'll call themselves maybe 50 cents or 30 cents, you know, at least $1, but they, and so forth. So they'll call themselves and give them names that are less, just like these two thieves are Al-Muhanan. But the Prophet ﷺ said, "No, you are not Al-Muhanan. You're not the despised ones." Remember, they had just accepted Islam. And he said, "You are Al-Mukraman, the honorable ones now, the honorable ones." So what's the lesson that we can learn from here? The lesson that we learn from this incident is that even though the society has rejected a certain people, as Muslims, we shouldn't reject them. We shouldn't reject them. In other words, we should make da'wah even to the people who are in jail and in prisons and so forth. And even though the society has rejected them and has despised them and so forth, but they also deserve the message, and we should come forward to them and bring the message to them also and not put them aside. Sometimes they're the ones who are more in need of it because of the state they might be in. And as Muslims, we do not differentiate between this race and that race, this type of person and that type of person, this class and that class. We don't have any class status and so forth. So all of them, they deserve the message of Islam. And so that's one of the lessons that we can take from this incident. Another thing that happened immediately when the Prophet ﷺ arrived, what did he do? What he did was he brought the two warring tribes together, and he built a relationship, a brotherhood between the Meccans, the Muhajirun, the immigrants who were coming from Mecca to Medina. He built, or he strengthened their uhuwa, their brotherhood, a specific bond of brotherhood. And that's why the Meccans, the people who come from Mecca, they were helped by the Medinites, or the Ansar, known as the Ansar. And they strengthened the bonds amongst the Muslims, even amongst the Ansar themselves, between the Khazraj and the Aus, the two warring tribes that had been at war for many years. And so the Prophet ﷺ brought them together, and he established a system of brotherhood, a system in which people would help each other, and they were to even inherit from each other at the beginning. Because these people who were coming from Mecca, the Meccans, they had left everything that they had. Many of them had barely anything with them. And so the people in Medina, they took care of them, and there was a bonding of brotherhood. Why is this important? Because every religion, every idea is only only as strong as its followers. If its followers are strong, then that religion and that idea is strong. And so you have to, in order to establish a community, strengthen the bonds of brotherhood. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ emphasized this. And he said, لا يؤمن أحدكم. As Muslims, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. None of you. You shall not believe, you will not have true faith until you love for your brother what you love for yourself. You have to realize that loving your brother more than even what you love for yourself, this a lot of people misunderstand, or they understand it, but they think it's a high level of faith and iman. No. This is the minimum requirements for Muslims. The minimum requirement is that you love for your brother what you love for yourself. The praiseworthy level is when you love for your brother more than what you love for yourself. وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيُؤْثِرُونَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَلَوْ كَانَ بِهِمْ خَصَاصَةً. And they prefer others over themselves, even if they're in dire straits. In other words, if they need it more, they prefer others over themselves. And that's why when you give and you help as Muslims, you give that which is beloved to you. And that you prefer even your brothers over yourself. That's the praiseworthy status. That's the status that is praiseworthy. As for the status that you want for your brother, what you want for yourself, that's the minimum requirement. So as Muslims, the lesson that we can take from here is that in order to strengthen our Islam, in order to strengthen our iman, we have to strengthen the bonds amongst ourselves first. Why? Because if we love each other, it helps us to worship Allah more peacefully. And we can get more things done. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, لا تدخلوا الجنة حتى تؤمنوا. You will not enter paradise until you believe, until you have faith. ولا تؤمنوا حتى تحابوا. And you shall never, you will not believe and have faith until you love each other. أفلا أدلكم على شيء إذا فعلتموه تحاببتم أفشوا السلام. Would you like me to show you something that if you're to do it, you will love each other? Spread the salam. So this is the first step. When you give salams to somebody, when you greet them, whether you know them or not, that's the first step in bonding. So if you established a strong community by having the individuals in the community love each other, when you want things to be done, it's much easier and you can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with more peace. And that's why we will never have faith until we truly love each other. And so in building, in da'wah, you have to build that bond also. You have to try to increase that bond and strengthen it so that the community and the individuals in the town, we love each other for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Another lesson that we learn from the Medina stage is that Islam prospers in peace, not in war. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Muslims in the sixth year of the Hijrah a surah. This surah, or these verses and this chapter, is known as Surah Al-Fath. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بعد أن أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. Indeed, we have given you a clear victory. What kind of victory? Did the Muslims defeat the non-Muslims in killing them? Did anybody die? No. What kind of victory was this? This is peace. What happened? It was after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah when the Muslims agreed with the Meccans to have an armistice for 10 years. In other words, they would stop fighting each other for 10 years. Because of that treaty, Allah revealed this ayat, Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. Indeed, we have given you a clear victory, a true victory. What is this clear victory? It is peace, because Islam prospers in peace, not in war. Islam calls for peace, not war. And that is why more people in the Arabian Peninsula, after this treaty, accepted Islam than all the years. How many years before? 13 years in Mecca and 6 years later in Medina also. How many years is that? Almost 20 years. Almost 20 years. But you know what? After that, just 17 months, more people accepted Islam in those months than all of those 19 years before that. Why? Because Islam prospers in peace, not in war. True victory is the achievement of peace, not the victory in war. So we will break right now, and we hope you stay in your seats.
He sent his messengers to
the value of money in the hereafter will be measured by its proper use in the present.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu anfiqoo mimma razaqnakum min qabli an ya'tiya yawmun la bay'un fihi wa la khullatun wa la shafa'ah.
According to the glorious Quran, one of the best ways to use your money is to spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by spreading His message of Islam. Peace TV is a non-profit Islamic satellite television channel that is primarily dedicated for just that cause, the proper presentation of Islam. It's a great choice to invest in it and a golden opportunity to purify your wealth in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donations to IRFI Al Rayan Bank, 47 Calthorpe Road, Birmingham, UK. B151TH. Pound account number 01132301. IBAN GB49ARAY 3000830113230 1. Sort code 300083. SWIFT BIC code ARAY GB22. Please confirm your contribution at support@peacetv.tv.
Support Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
He sent his messengers.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. We are speaking today about the lessons that we can derive from incidents that occurred in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and pertaining to da'wah. And so we spoke about the Treaty of Hudaybiyah and how it was a turning point in the Islamic da'wah. You know, in Hudaybiyah, there were only 1,400 people. 1,400 people went from Medina to make Umrah with the intention to make Umrah. But when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was victorious in Mecca, when he conquered Mecca, just less than 2 years later after the treaty, because the Banu Bakrin and the Quraysh, they had broken the treaty. So when the Muslims came, there were over 10,000. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in times of peace, now had the luxury to go and deliver the message and call people to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Before this occurred, before the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent companions to the different areas. And one such incident, one such tragedy, the tragedy of Mu'una, over 60 companions, 68, actually 70 were sent and only 2 returned. They were ambushed and killed. The scholars of Islam were ambushed and killed. But after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, the Muslims were able to freely go and deliver this message and convey this message to the non-Muslims in the Arabian Peninsula, or in and around Mecca and Najd, without fear of being ambushed like before. And that's why Allah called this a great victory. During the Treaty of Hudaybiyah also, there's another lesson we can take from one incident that occurred in writing the treaty. The Prophet ﷺ ordered Ali ibn Abi Talib to write down the clauses in the treaty. And this was the treaty of Hudaybiyah, and Suhail ibn Amr was there. And he was representing the Quraysh. And so the Prophet ﷺ, he said, write Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Write Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Suhail ibn Amr, he said, what's Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim? Who's Ar-Rahman here? Write like we used to write before. Bismika Allahumma, in your name, O Allah. Don't write Bismillah, in the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful. He said, don't write like that. Erase it. So the Prophet ﷺ ordered Ali ibn Abi Talib to erase. Now this is a condition. Suhail ibn Amr not wanted to write Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, write. Because remember, the Prophet ﷺ was illiterate. He did not know how to read nor write. But in fact, this is a miracle in itself, in that the Prophet ﷺ did not know how to read or write. Revelation is coming from the heavens. If you are receiving knowledge from the all-knowing, the one that knows all, you don't need to go around reading other people's books and taking ideas from the creation when you got your information, when you have your information coming through revelation from the all-knowing, the almighty, the creator of the heavens and the earth. So the Prophet ﷺ did not know how to read nor write. And so he said, O Ali, write, this is a treaty between Rasulullah, the messenger of Allah, and the Quraysh, represented by Suhail ibn Amr. And so Suhail said, wait, hold, don't write the messenger of Allah. If I believe that you were the messenger of Allah, do you think I would be here right now writing this treaty? I would be with you guys. Write Muhammad, like we know you, Muhammad the son of Abdullah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, not Rasulullah. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and the companions were like, why is this guy being so picky? These little details, things, you know, they were angry at Suhail ibn Amr for causing this problem and insisting on some of these things. And they were already angry with the agreement already. But this was just like more fire to the haystack, adding fire to the haystack. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, O Ali, erase it. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he said, O Messenger of Allah, you are the Messenger of Allah. I know that you are the Messenger of Allah. Why do we need to erase it? But the Prophet ﷺ said, where is it at? Because he doesn't know how to read, remember. So he says, where is it at? And so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam erases Rasulullah with his own hand. But what's the lesson that we can take from here? The lesson that we can take from here is that the benefit, the greater benefit in having the treaty being ratified by both parties is greater than just these little minor details. It might be little, it might be very... This is the Messenger of Allah, but he is not respecting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but still, for the greater benefit, the little, the minor, the other details, we can live without them. And so we can compromise in what is permissible. But some people, they use this particular incident and they exaggerate in using it in terms of compromise. But you have to understand, when it comes to compromise, we don't compromise the principles of Islam. We don't compromise when it comes to the main principles relating to Tawheed. For example, when the Mushrikun, when they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they said, we will worship your Lord for 1 year and you worship our Lord for 1 year. And another narration is, we worship your Lord for 1 month and you worship our Lord for 1 month. So we'll compromise on that. وَدُّوا لَوْ تُدْهِنُوا فَيُدْهِنُونَ. They would love it if you would only compromise with them. And they would do the same thing. But you know, when it comes to certain things, there's no compromise when it comes to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't go around worshiping others for 1 month and then we change back and worshiping Allah alone and then go back to worshiping. There's no. Allah revealed immediately, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. Say, O Muhammad, O ye who disbelieve, لا أعبد ما تعبدون. I shall not worship what ye worship. ولا أنتم عابدون ما أعبد. And you should not worship what I worship. And so there's no compromise when it comes to the principles of Tawheed. And there's no compromise when it comes to things that are related to shirk and so forth. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he defeated the tribe of Thaqif, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sending companions out to destroy the different idols, he went to Thaqif, he sent some companions to destroy the idol of known as Al-Lat that they used to worship. And so the people of Thaqif, the leaders of Thaqif, and they came and said, allow us to keep Al-Lat for 3 more years. The Prophet ﷺ said no. And then they said, well then, let us keep Al-Lat for at least 1 more month. The Prophet ﷺ said no. Until finally, they said, well, if you're going to destroy it, this idol, then let us destroy it ourselves. And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, go ahead. If you want, you can destroy it yourself, instead of me sending somebody to destroy it. So you see this, the Prophet ﷺ agreed because it didn't go against the principles. It didn't matter who destroyed the idols, but the idols have to be destroyed because they cannot be left for people to worship these idols. Once a person says, La ilaha illallah, there's no deity worthy of worship except Allah alone. And so that's one of the lessons that we learn from the Medina period. And one of the most important lessons that we can learn from the Medina period is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the munafiqeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent many ayats. In fact, there's one surah, a chapter known as Al-Munafiqun. And Allah speaks about them in Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah speaks about them in Surah Al-Ahzab. Allah speaks about them in Surah Al-Tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions and speaks about them and how we deal with them. The way that the Prophet ﷺ dealt with them in the da'wah is very important, because in our time we have many hypocrites and so forth. How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teach the companions and teach the Prophet ﷺ to deal with them? First of all, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ knew who the real hypocrites were. He knew that these people were not Muslims, that they were only pretending to be Muslims, but because they said that they were Muslims, the Prophet ﷺ did not judge them in their internal beliefs, even though he knew that they were hypocrites. Why? As lessons for us, that when we judge, we just judge by what's apparent. We do not delve into the hearts of men and say, I think you believe in this and that. I think you're this and that. No. Whatever people show us, apparently, that's how we deal with them. And that's very important. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ did not kill the munafiqeen. When they did things against Islam, they hated the Muslims, but they pretended to be Muslims. But the Prophet ﷺ didn't kill them and forbade the companions from killing them. And he knew who they were. Why? Because there's another benefit that comes from that. And that is so that people will not say that Muhammad kills his companions. Because other people do not know. So we deal with people just by what they show us. And this benefit came when, in the case of Wahshi. Wahshi was the one that killed Hamza, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was so afraid when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went into Mecca that he fled to Al-Ta'if, because he was afraid that the Prophet would not forgive him. And he was reflecting and thinking about going to Yemen or Sham, until somebody came to him and said, Muhammad does not kill his people. In other words, if you say you're Muslim, no matter what you did before, he will not kill you. And so because of that, Wahshi came and said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. That's how he dealt with the munafiqeen, and how that benefited other people, even no matter what they did before, that after they accepted Islam, that they would not be punished for the previous actions or whatever they did. And so these are just some of the lessons and thousands of lessons that we can take from the seerah and from the Medina period in relation to the da'wah and the fiqh and the art of da'wah. And that's all the time that we have for today. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our deeds and to increase our iman and make our deeds sincere. Wa jazakumullahu khayran. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa tubi ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
He created the universe. To Him belong the heavens and the earth. The ever-living, He is the first. He's the owner of mercy. He sent His messengers to warn His creatures of the grave dangers of worshiping other than Allah. There is none greater than the Creator.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is your brother in Islam, Mamdouh Muhammad. You're watching Peace TV, the solution for humanity.